How are you, Rob?
ערב טוב, everyone.
שלום
Who's
רב,
with us?
שלום רב, שלום רב.
Hello, Dr. Liz. Who else with us? Let's just say hello to everyone. Hello, Louis. Hello, Louis.
Hello. I'm
How are
back
you,
in.
Louis?
I'm fine. I'm back in edit Israel. I've got my wife here, and
Okay.
has to bring her in the plane. So the insurance company organized that I had a bed in the plane, and that's how I brought her.
Wow, that's amazing. Baruch Hashem,
Yeah.
and how she's doing.
Slowly, slowly. Very sore. Very, very
Okay.
sore. It's going to take
Please,
time. No, it'll
please
take
God
time.
refresh to Malka bat Rachel, like we usually
Thank
daven
you.
for her. We dedicate the show. I see Dr. Les with us, Hilton with us, Jeffrey with us, who else with us? Ivor with us, Frank with us. I see Lawrence with us. Who else with us? Okay. So most of the people with us. Dr. Les Bechavod, we're waiting
Okay.
for your update.
Okay, so Rob, as you all know, Tisha B'Av, we were on tenterhooks. We didn't know what it was going to be. There was so much speculation that both Iran and Lebanon would be firing missiles, and the whole country was really, every minute of Tisha B'Av was so significant, and we were davening. And B'ezrat Hashem, my prayers were in a way answered because nothing did happen on Tisha B'Av. And even now, today, there's these talks in Doha. Hamas aren't attending, but they've got their offices in Doha. So this is, like they say, a last attempt effort to reach some type of solution. And time is running out, and for the family of the hostages, our hearts go out to them because each neshama is so precious, and it's not a simple thing. But we need to bring them back. We really do. So B'ezrat Hashem, it should be successful, these talks. And we are strong, and they're saying that we're destroying a lot of the tunnels in the Rafah crossing in the Philadelphia corridor because they think that an agreement will be made. And just to mention, I don't think you'll get it in the news in South Africa or anywhere else, but there were 11 Palestinian children with cancer that were taken through Israel for treatment. And that won't be in the world media because positive things, unfortunately, about what Israel does is very rarely, it's really reported in the world media. But we know the MS, and we just hope that Hashem helps us in these negotiations, and that not only the hostages, these are fellow Yidden, that they come, and not only Yidden, there's also non-Jews that were also taken. Every single neshama, every single person that is Israeli or comes from Israel is precious. We just hope they come home safely. And our soldiers come home safely.
Be'ezrat Hashem, Be'ezrat Hashem, please God, we'll see Yeshuot, Yeshuot. We have, Rabotai, we finished Tisha B'Av, like Dr. Les said. We're starting from this Shavuos Shiva Denechama. What does it mean? 7 weeks that we're going to read on a Haftarot about comfort, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu comfort us. And the first haftarah that we're going to read this week, Nahamu, Nahamu Ami. Okay, so Be'ezrat Hashem, we'll see the Nehama, we'll see the comfort. HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Be'ezrat Hashem, will comfort us by that he will release the hostages. And more important than anything, that he send us Mashiach Tzidkenu in our days, in peace, in tranquility with not chorus. Amen. Ken Yeratzon. Rabotai, I would like to start the show. I would like to dedicate the show in the soul of Esther Kaden Bat Ketia, Mordechai Ben Rahma, Tamar Bat Zehava, Eitan Ben Keren Ve'Avishai, Malka Regina Bat Joya, Yaakov Salomon Ben Parha, Parha Bat Salha, Ve'Yafa Bat Kalma, Nishmatam Tiet Tzurura B'Tzur Haim. I also would like to dedicate the Shaor in the health of Liora Bat Miriam, Nashe Naji Ben Parha, Harav Moshe Ben Baia Batia, Harav Moshe Ben Devora, Harav Shlomo Yehuda Ben Devora, Harav Shlomo Yehuda Ben Dalia, Harav Avraham Ben Marina Devora Bat Esther, Shaina Keila Bat Hana, Mordechai David Ben Lea, Yehuda Hillel Ben Shulamit Lea, Haim Nahum Ben Pesa Reza Kohen, Baruch Ben Sarah Hiena, יהודה בן אליעזר, מאיר בן יהודה, אריאל בת בן שילת, פסח יצחק בן אלה, איילה עדן בת רסקה, אורי בן יעל, חנניה שלום בן אביגדור, מלכה בת רחל ונחום זאב בן שיינה רבקה. פליז גאד, רפואה שלמה טו דם ולכל חולי עמו בית ישראל בכל מקום שהם. פליז גאד, רפואה שלמה טו אול אוף דם. We're going to start the show, רבותיי. This Shabbos we're going to read the second parsha on the last book from the fifth book of Moses, Parashat Vayetchanan, and Be'ezrat Hashem we try to see what we can learn from this parsha. So Be'ezrat Hashem na'aseh v'natzliach, ve'Hashem alenu berachamav yarviach. Vayetchanan el Adonai ba'et ha'i le'emor.
Good evening. I implored Hashem at that time, saying,
okay, I employed, okay?
Implored.
Implored, okay.
Implored. It's like begging.
Yes, 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 implored, okay? Like imploring, okay? In a pshat of the dvarim, Moshe Rabbeinu tell the Jewish people that he davened to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and he begging HaKadosh Baruch Hu to enter the land of Eretz Israel. That's the pshat of the dvarim. But the Mefarshim ask, why is it say that Moshe Rabbeinu flowed to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, begged to HaKadosh Baruch Hu? Why didn't he say that he davened to HaKadosh Baruch Hu? What can we learn from that, that it says Vayitchanan, that Leitchanen, it's Milshon Hanina, that means to beg. Why did Moshe Rabbeinu have to plead, have to beg HaKadosh Baruch Hu to enter the land of Eretz Israel? Why didn't say that Moshe Rabbeinu davened? Why Moshe Rabbeinu didn't say that he davened? That's what we have to understand. Said the Mefarshim that here Moshe Rabbeinu come to teach us something very important. By that it says, Vayitchanan el Adonai, ba'et ha'i, that plead to the Almighty, a beg the Almighty, come to teach us that when a person is in a situation that he need help from HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and a situation that no one else can help him, how he should daven to HaKadosh Baruch Hu? How should he plead to HaKadosh Baruch Hu? How should he beg to HaKadosh Baruch Hu? Said the Zohar HaKadosh, that here, a matter of fact, the Zohar HaKadosh, in our parsha in Resh Samech is 260 verse 1. Here it's come to tell us that here Moshe Rabbeinu given us advice that when we're in a dire strait, how to daven to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. That means to plead to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, to beg to HaKadosh Baruch Hu to help us. And not has v'shalom, God forbid, to demand HaKadosh Baruch Hu to do. There's many people say, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, you must help me. HaKadosh Baruch Hu doesn't owe you nothing. You can say, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, please help me. HaKadosh Baruch Hu, I need your help desperately. Speak to the Almighty, say Hazal, that when you speak to the Almighty, he listen to you. But when you demanding, Kadosh Baruch Hu say, who you are to demand? Do you have rights to demand? I'm speaking for myself, Chas v'Shalom, not to anyone else. We have to understand that we have, when we're speaking, when we're davening, even in a tefillah, when we're standing and davening to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, we have to plead to HaKadosh Baruch Hu to help us with whatever is it. If we need health, if we need wealth, if we need shidduch, the children need shidduchim, people need certain things, we have to plead to HaKadosh Baruch Hu to help us. certain people sometimes need shidduchim. For example, a person looking for a husband or for a wife. He mustn't say, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, you must help me to find a wife. HaKadosh Baruch Hu doesn't owe us nothing. And said the Mefarshim that from here you learn, that's include the Zohar HaKadosh, that we have to learn how to daven to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. That even if the first davening that we daven never been answered. And we'll see now what Hazal tell us about the word Vaitchanan. We'll do the gematria. Hazal explained that the word Vaitchanan, if you do the gematria, is 515. Moshe Rabbeinu plead to HaKadosh Baruch Hu 515 times to enter the land of Eretz Israel. Okay? And after all of that, adore all of that, he didn't enter the land of Eretz Israel. Why? Because we learn about it shortly. Why HaKadosh Baruch Hu didn't allow Moshe Rabbeinu to enter. But what is the Hiddush here? The Hiddush here is to teach us how to daven, how to plead, how to beg HaKadosh Baruch Hu when we need help. That's the Hiddush here. If we see that HaKadosh Baruch Hu didn't answer our prayer in the first time, not in a second time, not in a third time, not in a tenth time, we must never stop. We must never lose hope. That's what Moshe Rabbeinu tried to teach us. That every prayer, in the end, will penetrate the wall that we have. Depends how much, how thick is the wall. What does it mean, thick of the wall? How much avirot we done? That's what we have to go through with the davening. Every time that you daven and you plead to HaKadosh Baruch Hu and you ask for forgiveness, you're making that distance narrower and closer and closer. That's what Moshe Rabbeinu tried to teach us by the word Vayit Hanan. But also a beautiful question that been asked by Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra. Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra, born 935 years ago in the city of Toledo in Spain. Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra asked a very interesting question. He said the book of Dvarim is a book of rebuke. The Torah starts when Moshe Rabbeinu rebukes the children of Israel. Later on, we'll see that Moshe Rabbeinu continued to rebuke the children of Israel. In Parashat Va'ekev, he rebuked them. As a matter of fact, in Parashat Va'ekev, he told them exactly where they done wrong. Come Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra and say, wait, I don't understand. What is the Hiddush here? That Moshe Rabbeinu, in the middle of the rebuking the children of Israel, speaking to them and telling them how many times he pleaded to the Almighty that HaKadosh Baruch Hu will allow him to enter the land of Eretz Israel. What is the Hiddush here? Why, in the middle of all the rebuking that Moshe Rabbeinu spoke to the children of Israel, suddenly he telling them that he pleaded to HaKadosh Baruch Hu 515 times? What is the Hiddush here? Say Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra, something extraordinary, a beautiful answer. Look how he explained it. And he said like this. Say Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra, the children of Israel now standing just before the entering the land of Eretz Israel. By the way, it was in the year 2488 from the creation. Bnei Israel left Egypt in the year 2448 from the creation. 40 years later, it's 2488 from the creation. Moshe Rabbeinu, just before he died, obviously rebuking the children of Israel, but he also tell the children of Israel, listen, I daven to the Almighty 515 prayers to allow me to enter the land of Israel. And in the end, HaKadosh Baruch Hu denied and didn't allow me to enter the land of Eretz Israel. What's the Hiddush here? C'est Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra. He says here Moshe Rabbeinu wanted the children of Israel to understand the virtue of Eretz Israel. How important Eretz Israel. That now you're standing before you entering the land of Eretz Israel, that you have to appreciate the land that you're going to inherit. Say Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra, that's why Moshe Rabbeinu, in the middle of all of it, he's suddenly speaking about what? Entering the land of Eretz Israel. How important is it? Why it was so important for him? That he told us that we have to appreciate the land of Eretz Israel. That means Moshe Rabbeinu was the father of all the prophets. HaKadosh Baruch Hu said, Pe el pe adaber elav. I spoke to him mouth to mouth. To who? To Moshe Rabbeinu. And Adosa, that he was the father of all the prophets that we have, he didn't merit to enter the land of Eretz Israel. Say Moshe Rabbeinu to the children of Israel, I played 515 times. Say Rabbi Avraham Ezra to teach us how important is Eretz Israel. Moshe Rabbeinu said to the children of Israel, you now ready to enter the land of Eretz Israel. Appreciate what you going to do, because I didn't merit to enter the land of Israel, but you will merit to enter. Therefore, appreciate that beautiful land. Therefore, make sure that when you're entering the land of Eretz Israel, make sure that you look after it. And not only that you look after it, you're going to appreciate it and keep the holiness of Eretz Israel. Let's go to verse 26. In verse 26, it says something very interesting. Here we see that HaKadosh Baruch Hu, let me just get there. Okay, verse 26. Let me say it and then I'll explain. Vayitaber Adonai bi lema'anchem, ve'lo shama elai. Vayomer Adonai elai, rav lecha, al tosef, daber elai od badavar hazeh.
That Hashem became angry with me because of you, and he did not listen to me. Hashem said to me, it is too much for you. Do not continue to speak to me further about this matter.
But heavy. Why did HaKadosh Baruch Hu got cross with Moshe Rabbeinu? Where does it say that HaKadosh Baruch Hu got cross with Moshe Rabbeinu? So let me explain. That it was when HaKadosh Baruch Hu told Moshe Rabbeinu, speak to the rock. Moshe Rabbeinu hit the rock instead. HaKadosh Baruch Hu got angry with him. So because of that, not going to enter the land of Eretz Yisrael. That's the pshat of the Torah. But we have to understand, why did HaKadosh Baruch Hu say, Vayomer Adonai Elai, Rav Lecha, Al Tosef, Daber Elai Od, Badavar Zeh. Do not speak to me anymore about that subject to enter the land of Eretz Yisrael. What's the Hiddushim? On pshat of the Dvarim, HaKadosh Baruch Hu tell Moshe Rabbeinu, don't speak to me about it anymore. I don't want to hear about it anymore. Don't daven to me anymore. Said the Mefarshim. Why did HaKadosh Baruch Hu told him? Few reasons. Number one, if Moshe Rabbeinu would daven one more, if he will plead one more time, he will enter the land of Eretz Yisrael. HaKadosh Baruch Hu saw that Moshe Rabbeinu not planning to stop pleading. He's going to continue davening. Kadosh Baruch Hu said to him, stop, until here. Now you're going to stop. Because he knew if he's going to daven one more plead, if he's going to plead to the Almighty one more time, he will enter the land of Eretz Israel. So what's so bad if Moshe will enter the land of Eretz Israel? What's so bad about it? Why? Why did HaKadosh Baruch Hu didn't want him to enter the land of Eretz Israel? I saw a beautiful commentary by Rabbi Meir Pepirash. Rabbi Meir Pepirash just for general knowledge, he born in a city of Krakow in Poland 400 years ago. And he wrote a book, Tal Orot, The Dew of Light. And he says something very interesting. He explained why did HaKadosh Baruch Hu actually stop Moshe Rabbeinu from davening one more prayer. He didn't want him to plead one more time. Why? Rabbi Meir Pepirash. By the way, Rabbi Meir Pepirash was student of Rabbeinu Ari HaKadosh, Rabbi Yitzhak Luria Ashkenazi. Okay? He said like this. He said that if Moshe Rabbeinu would daven one more prayer, 516 prayers, he will enter the land of Eretz Israel. HaKadosh Baruch Hu didn't want him. Why? Because Hazal in the Gemara in Masechet Sota in page 9, folio 1, tell us something very interesting. That whatever Moshe Rabbeinu done and whatever David HaMelech done, no one can destroy what they built. For example, Moshe Rabbeinu, we know that was in charge about the Mishkan, the tabernacle. The tabernacle, you have to understand, be stored away. No one managed to put his hand on the Mishkan. David HaMelech built the foundation for Beit HaMikdash that weighs the Western Wall. No one managed to destroy it. They managed to destroy the entire Beit HaMikdash. But the Western Wall that Moshe Rabbeinu built, that David HaMelech built, no one can destroy it. Moshe Rabbeinu, that was in charge about the Mishkan, build the Mishkan, erect the Mishkan, no one managed to put his hand on it. It's been stored away until Mashiach will come. Say Hazal in a Gemara, say Rabbi Meir Pepirash, he bring in the Gemara in Masechet Sota, remember page 9, folio 1. He say, in that case, if Moshe Rabbeinu will enter the land of Eretz Israel, if HaKadosh Baruch Hu would allow him, Moshe Rabbeinu will enter the land of Eretz Israel. He will do the fight that he has to fight to conquer the seven nation. Okay? After he conquered the seven nation, why Dafka seven? The Gemara tells us in Masechet Sukkah, in the end of Masechet Sukkah, that there is Sheva Shemot, the seven name, okay, L'Avodah Zarah. To idols, okay, Le'etzer Hara, etc. Say that here HaKadosh Baruch Hu have to destroy all of those seven nations because they each one of them assembling different character energy of the Avodah Zarah, of the evil forces. If Moshe Rabbeinu will enter, you have to destroy those Avodah Zarah. You have to appoint a king. Moshe will continue to be king. Then Moshe has to build Beit HaBechira. Moshe will build Beit HaMikdash. And if Moshe will build Beit HaMikdash, that Beit HaMikdash wouldn't be destroyed. Like Chazal tell us in the Gemara, Masechet Sota 9, folio 1, to tell us that then what's going to happen? HaKadosh Baruch Hu knew that the children of Israel inevitably gonna sin. And if they're gonna sin, you have to punish them. If you're gonna punish them, how's he gonna punish them? If they're gonna worship idol, you have to annihilate them, Chas v'Shalom. You have to take the anger. Where is the anger gonna go? Chas v'Shalom on the Jewish people. Then you have to annihilate them. Say HaKadosh Baruch Hu, I rather not allowed Moshe Rabbeinu to enter Eretz Israel. And someone else gonna build Beit HaMikdash that Shlomo HaMelech built the first temple. The second temple, it was Ezra Sofer. Okay. The Beit Dino. They erect the second temple. They build the second temple. I rather take my anger on stone, on wood. That's my house, and destroy Beit HaMikdash, that's the house of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and not to annihilate the Jewish people. So from here, we see the love of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. by that that he didn't allow Moshe Rabbeinu to enter the land of Eretz Israel, he showed the love to who? To the children, to us, that he chose us, to show us how much he loves us, that he rather has v'shalom destroy his own house, and he doesn't have the house, just to annihilate the Jewish people. So now you can understand, say Rabbi Meir Pipirash, why did HaKadosh Baruch Hu didn't allow Moshe Rabbeinu to enter the land of Eretz Israel? Why HaKadosh Baruch Hu stopped Moshe Rabbeinu from pleading one more prayer, one more time? That if Moshe Rabbeinu would daven one more prayer, that's it, the end. From here we see the love of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Okay, so now we can understand why did HaKadosh Baruch Hu command Moshe Rabbeinu not to plead anymore. Let's go to chapter 4, verse 2. Chapter 4, verse 2. And here the Moshe Rabbeinu tells the children of Israel something very interesting. And Be'ezrat Hashem will try to explain what's hiding behind it. And it says like this, לא תוסיפו על הדבר אשר אנוכי מצווה אתכם, ולא תגרעו ממנו, לשמור את מצוות אדוני אלוהיכם, אשר אנוכי מצווה אתכם.
You shall not add to the word that I command you, nor shall you subtract from it, to observe the commandments of Hashem your God, that I command you.
Okay. Here we see that Moshe Rabbeinu tell the children of Israel, do not add up on a mitzvot, and do not subtract. To not to subtract from the mitzvot of the Torah, everyone can understand. But why not to add up? What's wrong with adding up? That's the question of many of the Mefarshim. And I'm going to bring two ideas. The first one is Rabbi Moshe Alsher. And then we're going to bring Rabbeinu Bechaya. Or maybe we should start with Rabbeinu Bechaya because he was the older one. Rabbeinu Bechaya, born in a city of Saragossa in Spain 769 years ago. Rabbeinu Bechaya ben Asher. Okay? And in his commentary on the Torah, he said like this. He said the Torah is perfect. The Torah that we receive is the holy Torah that we receive from the Almighty. Our Torah, the Torah shebichtav and Torah shebe'al peh, the written Torah and the oral Torah, does not need you to add up. Why? Because that Torah been written by the Almighty. HaKadosh Baruch Hu given us that Torah. HaKadosh Baruch Hu, he wrote the Torah. He doesn't need us to subtract or to add up because we're not on a level to understand our Torah. So don't try to be uber chochem. Stay where you are. Don't try to show that you are clever. Just do what you have to do. That's Rabbeinu Bechaya. Come, Rabbeinu Moshe Alsher. Alshech HaKadosh, Rabbi Moshe Alsher. Rabbi Moshe Alsher born in a city of Andripoli. Andripoli is a city that called today Andripolia in Turkey. He born 518 years ago. And he said like this. He said, you know why the Torah tell you not to subtract? Everyone understand, Besed, not to subtract. But why not to add up? What's so difficult with adding up? He said, I'll tell you. He says, sometimes people think that they're doing mitzvot by that, that they're adding certain thing. And a matter of fact, they're doing averot. They're doing avera. He said, where did you see that? He said, we saw it not long ago. Where? When the children of Israel was in Arvot Moab. What's happened in Arvot Moab? Where's Arvot Moab? And the valley of Moab that was in the eastern part of Israel. By Jericho, Jordan, okay, across the Jordan Valley. He said, what's happened there? He said, I remind you, the children of Israel was fighting with the Midianites. But before that, they sinned with immorality. But what did they done? They saw that those pagan used to worship idols. They used to have avodah zara that called peor. That peor, what kind of idol worshiping is it? It's actually the most disgusting, despicable, the most despicable kind of avodah zara, idol worshiping. They used to have an idol. And excuse my language and excuse my the way that I'm going to express myself. But we have to explain that those pagan used to release themselves by doing feces on top of the idol. Yeah, there's today we don't understand that. When the children of Israel saw that, they say we're going to desecrate the Avodah Zarah more. What did they done? They eaten food that given them diarrhea. And when they have diarrhea, they gone and they done it on top of that Avodah Zarah. And they was thinking that they're going to desecrate the Avodah Zarah. But instead, they ate up more. Because this kind of Avodah Zarah is the most filthiest Avodah Zarah that there is. And in their mind, they was thinking that they're doing mitzvah. But they've done the biggest avera. They worship idols. The Rabbi Moshe Alshev, from here you can learn that sometimes a person think that he's going to do something extra. HaKadosh Baruch Hu say, make me a favor. Please, don't add up and don't subtract. You have 613 mitzvot. Do those mitzvot. I'll be happy. Don't try to be ubrho. That's the idea. Come to teach us sometime something very important, a very important principle. We as a human being, we don't have the capacity to understand the Almighty, the logic. Because we don't have logic. We think that we have logic, but we don't. Say Rabbi Moshe Al-Sheikh, just do what you've been told. Because sometimes we try to do more, but a matter of fact, we just damage him. That's the Hiddush here. What, why not to add up to the mitzvot? That's the Hiddush here. Let's go to verse 9 and 10. And Be'ezrat Hashem, in the end of the show, I'm going to link it to that. You'll see, I'm going to bring the Zera Shimshon. And verse 9 and 10, it says something very interesting. Rak yishamer lecha ushmor nafshecha me'od. Pen tishkach et hadvarim asher ra'u enecha. Upen yasur milvavcha kol yemei hayecha. Ve'odatam lebanecha.
Only beware for yourself and greatly beware for your soul, lest you forget the things that your eyes have beheld, unless you remove them from your heart all the days of your life, and make them known to your children and your children's children.
Here we see that Moshe Rabbeinu tell the children of Israel that they have to tell the story of Ma'amad Har Sinai. Ma'amad Har Sinai is when we receive the Torah on Mount Sinai. And not only to tell our children, to tell our grandchildren, our grand-grandchildren. What is the Hiddush here? What's hiding behind it? Say the Ramban. The Ramban is Rabbi Moshe ben Nachman. Rabbi Moshe ben Nachman, born in a city of Catalonia. Catalonia in Spain, 830 years ago. By the way, the Ramban was also a doctor. The same like the Ramban that we bring shortly. Say the Ramban like this. The Nachmanite. You say, that from here, according to him, this is a positive command from the Torah to tell the children, our grandchildren, our grand-grandchildren, what's happened in Mahamad Har Sinai. That means to emphasize to our kids, to our children, to our grandchildren, grand-grandchildren, what it was standing on Mount Sinai, receiving the Torah. And he said, not only that, that when you tell the story, say Moshe Rabbeinu, make sure that you say it in a way that your children, your grandchildren, your grand-grandchildren will feel like they were standing in Mount Sinai, like they was there. That means describe to them, analyze to them, explain to them what it was standing on Mount Sinai. That means explain to them how was the occasion when we received the Torah. What greatness, what's happened in the world, how the seven heaven opened, and how HaKadosh Baruch Hu given us the Torah and Mahamad Har Sinai. That even those that was blind, they got cured. Those that was handicapped got cured. Not only that, explain to them that when you stood on Mount Sinai and you was united, now HaKadosh Baruch Hu eliminate the deaths from the world. That means that every person become immortal, cannot die anymore. Until obviously shortly after that, that they have been seduced by the Erev Rav and died the golden calf. Come, Moshe Rabbeinu, and tell the children of Israel that we have an obligation to explain to our grandchildren, to our children, to our grand-grandchildren what was and how was standing on Mount Sinai. That means we must pass that story to our descendants, but in a way that they're going to think like they're standing on Mount Sinai. That's the Rambam. And now we can understand what Moshe Rabbeinu telling the children of Israel in these two verses. That's the Hiddush. Let's go to verse 15. Okay, verse 15. Oh, that's a beautiful one. Venishmartem me'od le'nafshotechem ki lo re'itim kol muna b'yom daber Adonai elechem b'chorev mitoch ha'esh.
Verse 13. He told you of his covenant that he commanded you to observe the 10 declarations, and he inscribed them on two stone tablets.
You read 13, I said 15. 15.
Oh, 15. I'm so sorry. I'm sorry.
No, okay, so you read another
sorry.
Verse. Yeah.
15, but you shall greatly beware for your souls, for you did not see any likeness on the day Hashem spoke to you at Horeb from the midst of the fire.
Okay. Venishmartem me'od le'nafshotechem. Hazal in the Gemara in page 32, folio 2. If you want to remember that, Lev is 32. Lev is a heart. In Hebrew, Lev, Gematria 32. Page 2. Hazal tell us in the Gemara in Masechet Brachot, 32, folio 2, Venishmartem me'od le'nafshotechem, that we have a positive command from the Torah to look after our health. A person has to make sure that he eats properly, he sleep properly, he drink properly, he rest properly. Okay? He exercise. Okay? Why? That we have an obligation to look after our soul. What is the Hiddush? That means it's not to exercise, to go to the gym, to show muscle, to be the cube in your stomach. That's no one interested about it. No, that's not what is it. It means to exercise, to walk. That means to make sure that your heart is working, to make sure that if you have a shower, you're not going straight outside in a cold wind. That's called v'nishmartem me'od lenafshotechem. That means if you eat, eat what you need. Don't over-exaggerate. If you smoke, that's already a negative command. Why? Because you're not looking after yourself. Said the Mefarshim that here it's come to teach us something very important, that we have a positive command from the Torah to look our after our health. That's so beautiful commentary of the Hafetz Chaim. The Hafetz Chaim, you all know, it's Rabbi Israel Meir HaKohen Miradim. And he born around 182 years ago, if I'm not mistaken. He born in Belarus. And he said like this, and his time, they didn't know, but he said that to smoke, I know that they found it only shortly, not long ago. He said that smoking, it's considered a negative command. Why? Because we know that when people smoke, we know people get sick. I don't want to mention. But people that smoke, it's actually doing, passing on a negative command, looking after their health. The Hafetz Chaim, 182 years ago. In a book of All Tzadikim, The Light of the Tzadikim, he explained that what is the Hiddush here? Why do we have to keep ourselves healthy? What is the Hiddush? He said that here the Torah comes to teach us that you have to sleep, you have to eat properly, you have to drink properly. You mustn't abuse your body. Why? So you'll have the energy to study Torah. Akadosh Baruch Hu tell you to look after your health so you'll have energy to study Torah. That's the Hiddush. V'nishmartem me'od lenafshotechem, to look after your health. That means that you sleep properly, you eat properly, you drink properly, you rest properly, that you can study Torah. That's the Hiddush. That's a beautiful idea that brought the Baal Shem Tov. Rabbi Israel ben Eliezer the Sarah say the Baal Shem Tov. He born around 306 years ago. He born in the Ukraine. And he said like this. He say, by the way, he started the movement of the Hasidut. The Hasidut, the Chabad movement, Hasidut Gur, Hasidut Breslev, and all the Hasidiyot that we have today, all of those pious group that we have today, started from whom? The Baal Shem Tov, Rabbeinu Baal Shem Tov, Baal Sheva Meorot. And he said like this, he said that sometimes when the Yetzer Ra see that the person actually looking after himself, that means sleeping properly, eating properly, drinking properly, resting, and etc. Not abusing the body, not challenging himself. Sometimes people embarrassed to wear a hat, a beanie, over their head, you know, in a cold weather. Sometimes people want to show off, walking with a short sleeve in the middle of winter. I don't understand what's the Hiddush here, but he said that when the Yetzer Hara see that he can't win you there, what does he tell you? Oh, you know what? You're a great tzaddik. You're a great righteous man. You're a great pious. What you must start? Now it's time to start to doing ta'aniyot. You should fast. You should certain thing of the day, don't drink, don't eat. Twice a week, Sheni v'Hamishim. He said that that's the itself Yetzer Hara. Who's those advice? From the evil inclination. Why? Because you see that he can, when you're worshipping HaKadosh Baruch Hu, you obey the mitzvot, he come and tell you, come and do extra. What is extra? Now it's time for you not to eat too much, not to sleep too much, okay, and etc. Fast every Monday, every Thursday. By that, that you're doing all of that, you actually can't focus on study Torah. So what he's doing is actually winning you. Why? Because HaKadosh Baruch Hu told you that you must look after yourself, that you can study Torah. But we know that on the day of the fast, we can't focus on study Torah. A human being, especially our generation, that very weak. Well, we all heavy-headed, you can't focus. Come to tell you, that's come from the evil inclination. HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants you to look after yourself. HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants you to be strong. Sorry. HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants you to be healthy, that you can daven to him, you can study Torah, you can worship him, that you'll have enough strength and enough energy to worship him. That's the Hiddush Ve'Nishmartem Me'od Nafshotechem, that you should look after your soul very much. I would like to go now to chapter 5, verse 1. And in chapter 5, verse 1, okay, we see something very interesting. And here the Torah tells us to teach the Torah. Look what it says here. It says like this. Sorry, I'm just there. Yeah. Vayikra Moshe El Kol Israel Vayomer Alehem Shema Israel Et HaChukim ואת המשפטים אשר אנוכי דובר באוזניכם היום ולימדתם אותם ושמרתם לעשותם.
Moses called all of Israel and said to them, Hear, O Israel, the decrees and the ordinances that I speak in your ears today. Learn them and be careful to perform them.
Okay. Shout of the Dvarim, Moshe told the children of Israel that listen what I'm telling you. I want you to learn, okay, and to perform those mitzvot. Come the Rambam. Now it's the Rambam. Before we mentioned the Ramban, and here's Rambam. Who was the Rambam? Rabbi Moshe ben Maimon, the Modmoni. He born in a city of Cordova 889 years ago in Spain. He also was in his profession, he was a philosopher, he was also a doctor, besides being a great scholar person that wrote commentary on the Torah, wrote for us many books that today we use him. And he said like this. He said in his book, Besefer HaMitzvot, in his book of the mitzvot, Mitzvat Aseh, positive command number 11. He said that from this verse, we're learning about learning Torah. Why do we learn? Why we have a mitzvah to learn Torah? He said that the mitzvah of learning Torah, it's not just to learn, it's to perform what we learn. That means that we have a mitzvah, positive command to learn, but we have also a positive command to perform the mitzvah. And then it says also vishmartem, to guard. That means that towards the negative command that in the Torah. That means the Torah come to teach us that there is something very important, that learning Torah, it's a mitzvah by himself. That it's a mitzvah that you have to learn, that when you learn it, you have to perform it. And Hazal tell us something very interesting in the Gemara in Masechet, in the Gemara in Yerushalmi, in Masechet Pe'ah, chapter 1, law number one, Hazal tell us something very important, that the mitzvah of studying Torah is equivalent to all the mitzvot that there is in the Torah. It's equivalent, studying Torah, it's equivalent to all the 614 mitzvot that we have. Why? Because when you learn Torah, automatically you have to perform it. You have to observe it and you have to perform it. That means that that's mitzvah equivalent to all the mitzvot that we have. He said that's the Hiddush that Moshe Rabbeinu tried to teach us. That Moshe Rabbeinu tell us, ulmadetem otam, that you have to learn Torah. Ushmartem la'asotam, that you have to make sure that you're going to perform the mitzvot. It's not enough just to learn mitzvot. A person learn about a mitzvah, let's say, to not to eat milk and meat. Okay, you learn it. But what does it mean not to eat milk and meat? That doesn't say anything. The Torah tells us, Lo tevashel gedi b'chalev imo, that you're not allowed to cook meat and milk together. From here, Chazal learned that you're also not allowed to eat. You're also not allowed to have a benefit from milk and meat together. That means if you cook meat and milk together, you're not allowed to sell it, to get a benefit from it. Benefit, by that you sell it, you get some money. Come to teach you that it's not enough just to learn it. You have to learn also to observe it. And that's the Hiddush here. That when we learn Torah, we have to perform what we learn. That's the Hiddush. Let's go to chapter 6. And we're going to read chapter 6, 4 and 5. And here we're going to see in chapter 6 something very, 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 very interesting that I would like to share with you. And verse 4, we're going to read one of the famous verse that we said three times a day, one in Shaharit, one in Arvit, and one before we go to sleep, that mitzvah Shema, Shema Israel. And then we see something very interesting and we go to depths, Be'ezrat Hashem. Let's read 4 and 5. Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Ve'ahavta, Et Adonai Elohecha, Bechol Levavcha, Ubechol Nafshecha, Ubechol Meodecha.
Hear, O Israel, Hashem is our God, Hashem is the one and only. You shall love Hashem your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your resources.
Okay. Rabotai, Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad, that verse, I think that it was with the Jewish people all our life, most of our life. People before they've been hanged, people before they executed, before they've been shot, before they've been killed, they say Shema Yisrael. Many people saved by saying Shema Israel. We heard about stories that people was thinking that a Jewish guy is actually a terrorist. And when they come to shoot him, he says Shema Israel, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. And they just then, they almost killed him. No, on the 7th of October. The next thing they realize is a Jew. That verse leading us, walking with us, we taking with us for decades. What's hiding behind it? And why is it say straight after that, Ve'ahavta et Hashem Elohecha b'chol levavcha u'b'chol nafshecha? That when you love the Almighty, love Him with all your heart and with all your soul. Be'ezrat Hashem will explain all of it. But before, if you look at that verse, Shema Israel, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad, the word Echad, in the end, And the word Shema, okay, they have two big letters. From the word Shema, the ayin is big. Ehad, the dalet is big. What does it come to tell us? He said that if you take the letters ayin and dalet, you get the word ed, witness. What is the hidush? It's come to tell you that HaKadosh Baruch Hu can witness, okay, that you sanctify Hashem. When we sanctify Hashem, that's when HaKadosh Baruch Hu, when we say Shema Yisrael Hashem Elokeinu Hashem Echad, that's when we sanctify the name of Hashem. That we take in oaths that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is our God. That's how we sanctify the name of Hashem. But that we're saying Shema, that Ayin, and then Ehad is Daled, that we're creating a witness that we sanctify the name of Hashem, that there is only one God. Not only that there is only one God, God, HaKadosh Baruch Hu is our God. We don't have any other God. That the Jewish people doesn't have, has b'shalom, that they worship someone else. That's the Hiddush. Say, Rabbi Chaim ben Attar. Rabbi Chaim ben Attar, born 328 years ago in the city of Salien, Morocco. And in his book, Or HaChaim HaKadosh, he says something very interesting. How can a person reach to a level that he can bring himself to understanding, to stimulate himself that the Almighty is one, and to love HaKadosh Baruch Hu. The Or HaChaim HaKadosh, by that the person will look that there is one God, one creator, that all the angels in the world, all the angels in heaven, and all the galaxies, and all the stars in the world, not only that they're admiring HaKadosh Baruch Hu, they're praising him, and they're bowing down to him. And from all what he created in the world, and all what he created on earth, from all of those universe, star, human being, HaKadosh Baruch Hu chose us to be his nation, to be his children. When a person look at that and saying to himself, look, HaKadosh Baruch Hu created the earth and heaven, seven heaven. How many galaxies, how many stars there is. And on top of all of those, these angels that bowing down to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, admiring HaKadosh Baruch Hu, praising HaKadosh Baruch Hu 24-7, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu from all of that chose us. From all the people that he created the world, chose us, the minority. Then you can understand what it means. Then you can reach to understand what it means one God. That HaKadosh Baruch Hu chose you, each one of us, that we the children of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Now how we can reach to understand what it means, that the Almighty is one. Why? Because he loves us more than anyone else. Say Rabbi Shimshon Haim Nachmani. Rabbi Shimshon Haim Nachmani says something very interesting. Rabota, just for general knowledge, if you want ever to remember where is that verse, Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu Hashem Echad, written, I'm going to give you a very simple remedy, very simple idea. Remember the name David. Daled, Vav, Daled. David. David, Dalet, Vav, Dalet. Three letters. The first Dalet is for Sefer Dvarim. Then comes Vav, that means chapter 6. Dalet, it's chapter 4, verse 4. That if anyone will ever ask you, where is the word, where is the verse, Shema Israel, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad, in the Torah, in the Tanakh, remember the name David, Dalet for Sefer Dvarim, for the book of Dvarim. Vav, it's chapter 6. Dalet again is verse 4. Okay? Just for us to remember. Said the Zera Shimshon, Rabbi Shimshon Chaim Nachmani. Rabbi Shimshon Chaim Nachmani, born in the city of Modena in the north of Italy, 318 years ago. In his book, Zera Shimshon, he says something very extraordinary. Rabotai, listen to it. Listen what he said. Sorry. He said like this. He said, wherever you mention the word love, immediately after that come something very interesting, heart and soul. Where do we see it? We see it in verse 5. What does it say in verse 5? Look what it says. Ve'ahavta, that's love, to love HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Bechol levavcha, that you should love the Almighty with all your heart and with all your soul. He says, I'll give you another idea. In next parsha, Parashat Va'ekev, in chapter 11, verse 13, it says like this, Le'ahava, to love your Hashem, your God, Bechol levavchem u'bechol nafshechem. Again, he said, the Zera Shimshon, wherever the word love mentioned, immediately after that come the word heart and soul. Okay? We never take notice of that. He said, why when it speak about the fear of heaven, he didn't mention the heart and the soul? How come? Li'ira et Hashem Elokechem, but he doesn't say, b'chol levavchem, b'chol nafshechem, that you should fear Hashem, your Almighty. Doesn't say with all your heart and all your soul. How come? So let me explain to you. He said, what does it mean, fearing HaKadosh Baruch Hu? A person that fears HaKadosh Baruch Hu doesn't do averot. Why? Because he's all the time alert. He doesn't want to have a problem with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. He said to himself, listen, I don't want chores. I'm going to do mitzvot. I don't want problem. He said that's a word's negative command, not to do averot. He said, but when it say to HaKadosh Baruch Hu ve'ahava, to love HaKadosh Baruch Hu, what does it say? Bechol levavcha ubechol nafshecha, with all your heart and all your soul. To love HaKadosh Baruch Hu with all your heart, with all your soul. That means that that's speaking about positive command. He said when it's come to positive command, quite often we do things because we love HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Okay? HaKadosh Baruch Hu tell us, for example, to put tefillin. We go and buy tefillin. HaKadosh Baruch Hu tell us to take the four species. We go and spend money on four species. I'm just giving an idea. It says, but sometimes we're doing those mitzvot when we on automatic gear. We forget where we are. I would like to speak about myself. You all tzaddikim. You know, when you're standing in the Amida and you start davening, you're starting to take off. And the next thing, you find yourself into work. If it's in China, if you're doing business overseas, if you're doing business in South Africa. And the next thing, before you realize, you already say, Oseh Shalom Bimromav. You're stepping three steps backwards. Ooh, I finished the davening. But where I was all over the world. Just two places I wasn't. Where I wasn't? With all my heart and with all my soul, with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Stay the Zera Shimshon, when it's come to positive come on, it's not enough to do it with love. This love you have to do with all your heart and with all your soul. That means that you have to focus when you're doing positive command. You have to focus and you have to do it with your heart and with your soul. Although that you love HaKadosh Baruch Hu and you want to do positive command, you have to remember to do it with all your heart, with all your soul. Nachon that we all love HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Nachon that we want to please HaKadosh Baruch Hu, but sometimes, because we do it with love, we do it on automatic gear because we get used to it. He said that every time that you stand up to put the tefillin, should be the first time in your life that you're putting the tefillin. That means doing it with such excitement, doing it with such a love that your heart and your soul been put to that mitzvah. The first time that you give tzedakah, that it's positive command, do it with all your heart, with all your soul. Rabotai, tzedakah we give only to a Jewish person, not to goyim. I have to make sure. Only if there is certain things that the Rabban explained, lo tehunem. What it means, lo tehunem, you're not allowed to give a goy tzedakah. If it's going to cause anti-Semitism or chas v'shalom hatred, then it's a different situation. But it's come to teach us that when you do mitzvat aseh from the Torah, positive command, and you're doing it with love, don't forget your heart and your soul to do that mitzvah. When we go and buy the four species, don't forget that you have to do it with full of your heart. When you shake the lula, and when you lift it up and down, when you hold the etrog, why am I doing it? What's hiding behind? That's the Hiddush. And Be'ezrat Hashem, I would like to conclude that nachon, that when it's come to negative command, we're very careful. Everyone careful to keep Shabbat. Everyone careful not to eat milk and meat. Everyone careful not to eat non-kosher food. Why? Because it's negative command. But when it's come to positive command, because we're doing it with love, quite often we put it also on automatic pilot. Okay? We forget that we have to navigate. Navigate, it means with all our heart and all our soul. Be'ezrat Hashem, that now that we learn why the word, after the word love, come, heart, and soul, it's to teach us that mitzvot, positive command, it's not enough just to do it. We have to do it with all our heart, with all our heart, and with all our soul, to focus also on a positive command. And then, Be'ezrat Hashem, HaKadosh Baruch Hu will see and that we're doing mitzvot with love, we're doing it with all our heart, we're doing it with all our soul, and He will open the heaven on us, bring prosperity to the world, peace, and the most important, He will send us Mashiach, Tetkenu speedily in our day. Amen. Ken Yehi Ratzon. Rabotai, I would like to take each one of you to say, first of all, Shabbat Shalom to all of you. That we have a peaceful Shabbat. Thank you for joining us tonight. Hope that you enjoyed. I hope that it brought a different way of looking at Shabbat. Those of you that have questions, please unmute the microphone and I try to answer your question. Bechavod. Ken. Antonio Erev Tov.
If Moshe Rabbeinu would have been to the land of Israel, would he have been the Mashiach? Would he have become the Mashiach immediately?
Antonio, I must tell you, I didn't hear the words. Your connection is not so clear. Maybe try to get closer to your Wi-Fi so I can hear you. You very break. The line is very, very bad. Sorry. You want to try again? I can't hear you. You're breaking out. You're breaking out, Antonio. Antonio, I can't hear you.
Antonio, walk around your house and go look for a better signal. Then at least you'll have to hear your question.
Antonio, did you hear what Louis suggests? To walk around, maybe you get a better signal. Frank, you wanted to ask a question? Bechavot, Frank?
Yes, I just want to understand something. It's not a question, it's just an understanding. You said Moshe built the temple wall, the first wall, which has not been destroyed.
No. That's David HaMelech.
So, but what did you say about? I know David HaMelech, but so what did I hear it wrong? Moshe didn't build the wall.
No, Moshe Rabbeinu built the tabernacle. You remember the tabernacle?
Yes. Yes, then I must have heard you. Okay, now that's all I wanted to ask. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Pleasure. Bechavod, Antonio, try again.
Can you make it quieter?
No.
Antonio? No, I can't hear you. Sorry, Antonio. I can't hear you breaking out.
Antonio, switch off your cell phone, switch it back on, and maybe you'll have a better signal.
Okay.
Try what Lee suggests. In the meantime, who else want to ask a question? Jeffrey, Bechavod?
Yes, Rob. I do have a...
Bechavod.
Right. Going to the beginning, as you did, Eschanan, and it's 515 times that Moshe begged Hashem to let him in. At the end of the day, it didn't work. It doesn't matter how you look at it, you can make explanation. So you keep praying, and it doesn't work.
It's almost work. HaKadosh Baruch Hu told them to stop, because Moshe Rabbeinu would continue.
Yes, because it's not going to work. But that's an example for us.
HaKadosh Baruch Hu didn't want to annihilate the Jewish people, so he told them to stop. But Moshe Rabbeinu would continue one more prayer and he would succeed. HaKadosh Baruch Hu stopped him.
No, I hear you.
What you're trying to say, I know where you're trying to get, that sometimes we're davening, if I'm not mistaken, that's what you want to ask.
Yeah.
And we don't see what we want to see. Nahon?
So
we don't receive what we want to receive. Yeah. You understand? Now I understand what you're trying to say.
Yeah.
So the Hiddush here is sometimes you have to understand sometimes HaKadosh Baruch Hu know that we, let's say a person ask to be a millionaire. HaKadosh Baruch Hu know that if you make a person a millionaire, a person, when he have money, he's going to lose. The thing going to go over his head. It's going to go over him. He's going to lose it. HaKadosh Baruch Hu say he want to be a millionaire. He want to be rich. And if I give him so much money, he actually going to lose it all. So let him daven. Maybe in the next world, when he's going to be a different person with a different soul, I'll make him a millionaire. But in this world, for him, it's not good to be a millionaire. Why? Because if I'm going to give him what he wants, it can cause him harm. For example, a child beg his father, buy me a bike. Every second minute that he sees his father, he asks his father to buy him a motorbike. But the father knows that a motorbike is a very dangerous transport, especially in South Africa.
Yeah.
So he said to his son, listen, I don't think it's a good idea. I don't think it's a good idea. And the thing going on and on and on. Does that mean that the father doesn't love the son? Not at all. The father loved the son. And because he loved him, he knows that this kind of a transport vehicle, it's very dangerous to him. He doesn't give it to him. Because if he hates him, immediately he would give him. You understand me, Jeffrey?
Yes.
So sometimes we dive into HaKadosh Baruch Hu for something that to us it looks like it's good for us. But as a matter of fact, it's not. It's dangerous for us. It's a dangerous tool. It's a dangerous vehicle. It's a dangerous transport. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu no better than us. And he doesn't give it to us. But to us, it's look like a Kadosh Baruch Hu doesn't listen to us. The same like the son look at his father that didn't bought him the motorcycle. Why? Because he think that the father don't like him, don't listen to him. But as a matter of fact, the father listened to him. The father listened to him so well that he know even better why he doesn't buy him a motorcycle. You follow?
Yeah.
I hope I answer your question.
Yes, it answered the question. There's one other question I'd like to
ask. Bechavot.
I just wonder if there's a connection here. You know, everything is middle connected, middle. We don't see it, but at the end of the day, that is always the way. Which how Hashem makes the thing. What do you do? You get returned from maybe not here, or maybe later, maybe from times. But here, Moshe says to the people that Hashem became angry with me, yeah, because he did not listen to me. And he said to Moshe, you know, it's too much for you. He said, do not speak to me. Do not speak to any further about this matter. Now, it seems like it's almost midah k'neged midah. Moshe didn't speak to the rock, and Hashem's saying to him, now don't speak to me.
Yeah. So
you didn't honor me. That's why you're not going
like
in.
This.
You're not going but, in.
But let me, can I take your question and develop it?
Right.
Did you ask yourself, the Hazal in the Gemara asked, why did Moshe Rabbeinu wanted to go to Eretz Israel? Moshe Rabbeinu, why do you want to go to Eretz Israel? Why you want to enter Eretz Israel? Why? You want to eat from a fruit? No problem. Kadosh Baruch Hu say, I'll bring you your fruit. What? You want to do the mitzvot that depends that you can make them only in Eretz Israel? I consider it like you done. Why do you want to go to Eretz Israel? Why it was so important to Moshe Rabbeinu to enter the land of Eretz Israel? That's the question. Let's ask like this. First, let's understand that. Before HaKadosh Baruch Hu told them, don't talk to me anymore about that subject. Said the Mefarshim on a pshat of the Dvarim, Moshe Rabbeinu wanted to enter the land of Eretz Israel, wanted to see the beauty of Eretz Israel, wanted to enjoy Eretz Israel. But he said, and I hinted to that in the beginning of the show, how many nations was in Eretz Israel, in Eretz Canaan? Sheva Amim, seven nations. Okay? Seven nations. Those seven nations, they awards the Sheva kind of Avodot Zarot, seven evil spirits, okay? Moshe Rabbeinu knew that if he going to enter Eretz Israel, he going to annihilate all the Avodah Zarah. And that's what he wanted to enter Eretz Israel. To annihilate all the Avodah Zarah. You understand the Hiddush?
Yeah, yeah.
HaKadosh Baruch Hu said to him, no, you can't do that. That's not your job. That's Yeshua's job. Yeshua didn't done it. You know who done it? Many years later, Ezra Sofer. Moshe Rabbeinu wanted to enter Eretz Israel to annihilate all the Avodah Zarah. That the children of Israel not going to worship idols. But that wasn't his job. HaKadosh Baruch Hu said to him, I don't want you to enter the land of Eretz Yisrael. You know why? Because if you're going to enter the land of Eretz Yisrael, I'll have to annihilate that nation that called the children of Israel. Because when they're going to make me angry, instead of destroying Beit HaMikdash that made from stone and from wood, I'm going to take my anger now on them, not burn Beit HaMikdash. And that means that I'm going to annihilate them completely. I don't want to do that. Why? Because at the moment that you're going to enter Eretz Israel, you're going to put an emphasis on there. You're going to make something that no one can destroy. So who I'm going to destroy if they're going to sin? Who I'm going to take anger? I'll have to take anger on them. And I don't want to do that. Say, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, you rather destroy his own Beit HaMikdash. Rabotai, on Tuesday we fast for the destruction of the temple. Do we understand what does it mean that we don't have Beit HaMikdash? We don't. I don't understand personally. But I just want to bring something small. You maybe all understand. I don't. You know what does it mean when there is Beit HaMikdash? When we look at the highly priest, the holy priest, the Kohen Gadol. Okay, we have few Kohanim here. Few Kohanim. Jeffrey, you're Kohen yourself. When we used to look at the clothes of the Kohen Gadol, that used to do atonement to us. We don't have it anymore. We don't understand what we're missing by that our temple is broken. Our temple is destroyed. We don't understand what it means, destruction. To look at the Kohen Gadol, to look at his clothes, just at his clothes, we're doing atonement to our sin. Do you understand what is Beit HaMikdash? Yeah. Just think like that. That's what we're missing. And we don't understand that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you understand? Do you understand the Hiddush here? We don't. I'm talking to myself. You all understand that you're all tzaddikim. I'm talking to myself. What can I do? That's what we're missing. We're crying for the destruction. You know why we're crying? Because we want Mashiach now. Why we want Mashiach now? That we're not going to have a war, that we're not going to have tzoras. But do we cry that HaKadosh Baruch Hu doesn't have a house? Do we cry that HaKadosh Baruch Hu doesn't have a house that we can go there to talk to him, to give him peace and tranquility? Do we cry really on Tisha B'Av? Let's be honest with ourselves. When we go to sleep in our bed and HaKadosh Baruch Hu doesn't have a house to go to?
Yeah.
You follow, Jeffrey?
Yeah.
I hope I answer your question.
Yes, sir. Thank you very
I
much.
I come from all corners. I try to answer your question from all different corners.
Yeah. Rava, this is one last one. If it's about an observation and maybe elaborate. We say the Shema, Yo Israel, Hashem, Kena Hashem Echad. The Hashem is our God, Hashem is one. This is our declaration of faith. This is our declaration of allegiance. It doesn't matter where we are in the world. It doesn't matter. We are not, it's not like other nations. They have allegiance to the crown, allegiance to the state, allegiance to it's to humans. We don't. We have allegiance to God only. That's the allegiance. Not that we don't have allegiance and we don't appreciate where we are and we're in different countries. We must do that. We're guests in these countries.
But we are told here that wherever you are, here we must acknowledge where our allegiance goes. And it's that just mentioned about the base of Mikdash, where is Hashem's home? We must feel it. We must love Hashem. We must love with everything. And we must understand that we need that base of Mikdash to bring his spiritual presence in our midst, that we can appreciate Hashem more. We can understand. And then the Shema takes on great significance. Hashem is one, and we must love him. We must love him. And when we do that, we show this love, that is when Hashem will give us a future, give us something of value. This is the only real thing of value is Hashem. Everything has got temporary value. It's here one day, gone tomorrow. But Hashem is always here with us. And here in his Torah, he's telling us, you know what? Listen, Israel, Hashem, I'm the one. I'm the only one, and I love you. And it's you got to love me. And when you do that, it makes a bond that nothing can defeat us. And it doesn't matter where we are in the world. This is what one can learn from what you've mentioned and connecting the base of the Mikdash, what you've just said now, and bringing Hashem down into this world. And we can show our allegiance physically as well as mentally, which we can do at the moment. It's only mentally we can do it. We can do it mentally, then we can accept and love. But when something's, we are humans, when something's in one's midst, then one can feel it in the midst. And we're all together, like we're in Shul, we feel it. There's a different feeling all together. So can you imagine if we feel this way in Shul, how much more when the base of Mikdash comes than when the Shem is around?
But how do you get to it? How do you get to it?
Yeah.
In a word, one. You say Had.
Yeah.
How do you write Had? Aleph, Het, Dalet. Listen what the Mekubalim say. That when you say Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad, you have to have in mind Aleph, the Almighty is the only one and the special one. There is no other Almighty. He's the one, he's the only one, and he's the special one. That's Echad. Okay?
Yeah.
Het. What is Het? That the Almighty in charge about the earth and the seven heavens. That's eight, because Het is eight. Aleph is one. Dalet is four. That the Almighty is in charge about the four sides of the world. The north, the south, the east, and the west. All the wind. HaKadosh Baruch Hu, when you imagine that there's only one God, that's Aleph, is one. The gematria of Aleph is one. The gematria of Het is eight, that the Almighty in charge about the earth and the seven heaven. And Dalet, gematria is four, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu, not only that he's in charge about the earth and the seven heaven, he's watch all the four corners of the world. When you're going to start to realize that, then you can reach to understand the love to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, who's the one. That every time that you say Shema, that's what you should have.
Yeah.
When you say Ehad,
yeah.
Why Hazal say to us, Ya'arich be'ehad, Ya'arich ba'dalet, that stretch the dalet, Ehad, the dalet, to have focus, Hashem Ehad, Meyuhad be'mino. He's a special, he's the only one. He's the master. Het, that he's in charge about that it's four, that the gematria is eight, that he's in charge about the earth and the seven heaven. And then Dalet, that he's in control of all the four sides of the world. He's still watching the world. The north, the south, the west and the east. The feather?
Yeah. Yeah.
I hope that you enjoy that. I hope that you enjoy that. Ken, Antonio, Bechavod, Antonio, unmute yourself. Let's try and see if we can hear you. Antonio, please unmute your microphone.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you vaguely. Try to get a better reception. You're almost there.
If Moshe would have entered the land of Israel, would he have been declared the Mashiach immediately?
When Moshe will enter the land of Eretz Israel, if the Jewish people wouldn't sin, okay? But inevitably, we know the difference. You know, if the children of Israel will do unity, we live in unity, the same like we stood in Mount Sinai, we was united, we received the Torah. Look what unity can do to the Jewish people. When the Jewish people stood in Mount Sinai united, immediately HaKadosh Baruch Hu given him the Torah. Took the angel of death, canceled the death from the world. We become immortal. Look the strength of unity. That will answer your question. If inevitably we know what's happened. We couldn't. Vaishman Yeshurun Vaivat. We say the prophet said that when it's too good for us sometime we become too arrogant, let's call it this way. Let's leave it with that word. I don't want to say something else. You follow what I'm saying?
Thanks very much.
Antonio?
Yes.
You follow?
Yes.
Okay. So inevitably. Any other question, Rabotai? Bechavod? No. Okay. Rabotai, I would like to wish all of you, first of all, Shabbat Shalom. Thank you for joining us tonight. Just to remind everyone, on Shabbos, an hour before Mincha, I give a shiur in a big shul at Yeshiva College. Those of you that can attend, I would love to see you with us. Be'ezrat Hashem. In the meantime, if I'm not going to see you on Shabbos, I would like to wish all of you a peaceful Shabbos, Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat of peace, Shabbat of rest, Shabbat of tranquility, Shabbat of good news, that Be'ezrat Hashem will see the Mashiach coming with no chorus, not with difficulty, with peaceful, with joy. But if not, we're going to still continue in the shiur about the prophet Samuel on Yom Rishon, Be'ezrat Hashem. In the meantime, thank you for joining us. Have a beautiful evening, beautiful weekend ahead. And the most important, that we have to enjoy our life, our family, to have balance in life, to make sure that we're worshiping HaKadosh Baruch Hu, not only with love, not just love, it's not enough love, like said Ezra Shimshon, with our heart and with our soul. That means when we're doing mitzvot, to bring the heart and the soul to the mitzvah. Ezrat Hashem, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu will have mercy on us, will send us Mashiach Tzidkenu. Good night, everyone. Thank you for joining us, and Shabbat Shalom to all of you. Shabbat Shalom.